Good morning and welcome to our Stop Breakfast program on MCL TV. Good morning, Abia. Ojaba is my name. It's good to welcome you to the Tuesday edition of the program that comes to inform, entertain and educate you. Right, the way we do it every morning is to start with the words on Marvel. That's our first part of call, talking about educating the people, and this morning says attitude is a choice. Each and every day that we arise, we have a choice on how we will view and interact with the world around us. Jim Rohn, attitude is a choice. Each and every day that we arise, we have a choice on how we will view and interact with the world around us. You have the right to decide to be happy. Well, you decide to be happy and you'll be happy and your day will be a happy one. But if for any reason you decide not to be happy, you decide to maybe get, you know, brood over, you know, every issue as you have them, you realize that, well, your world will be like that as well. So it's your choice. Hope you'll be able to make the right choice this morning to be happy and to do everything you have to do happily, especially with things around you, people around you. You need to, you know, show them love. You need to, you know, give what you have. And if there is no love in you, you can't give love. You can't give what you don't have. So let love be in you so that you'll be able to give it. Only that, so doing, will you be able to influence your surroundings. All right, let's go straight to Cynthia Chen. We already sit there for the news update this morning. Cynthia, how are you?
I'm doing well. Good morning. Good morning, Abian, and welcome to our news stand for the news. Good morning, Abian. Now on the news. President Muhammad Buhari on Monday in Abuja said his administration remained resolute and focused on delivering on the three-pronged promises of securing the lives and properties of Nigerians, halting the pillage of the economy by corrupt public officials, and creating employment opportunities for the youth. President Buhari stated this while when he received the board of directors of the Nigerian Economic Summit Group at the State House, Abuja. Buhari, in a statement signed by his special advisor on public and media and publicity, Chief Femi Adesina, said the initial economic challenge posed by recession was already dwindling, with the economy smarting out and posting better results on falling inflation rates, higher foreign reserve, and better ranking on ease of doing business. The president said the government will work more to accelerate and increase momentum in agriculture, power, gas, manufacturing, and processing, while commending the Chinese government for its support in improving infrastructure in Nigeria. He said the unfortunate incident of attacks, which has resulted in loss of lives and properties, had already brought sorrow and hardship on many Nigerians, with the government deeply affected. President Buhari said the government will continue to strengthen its relationship with the NESG, especially in integrating its recommendations into policies that will improve the livelihood of all Nigerians. The prevailing weather pattern has continued to elicit different reactions from members of the public. However, most associate different experiences to the dry spell which has swept across the land. In this report, MCL News highlights the challenging weather and the weather pattern and its effect on health and general well-being. Emeka Chibu tells us more on the report.
The past 2.5 months has witnessed a dry spell with almost no rainfall in Aba and adjoining communities and small towns. The weather has also been associated with heat wave, though the month of December saw the coming of the familiar cold Harmattan. However, in recent weeks, though the dry spell has persisted, often temperatures drop sharply at night, yet many complain of feeling hot, a situation which is often marked with excessive perspiration. This situation can best be described as an admixture of hot and cold weather, while day temperatures often remain high. A chat with an expert in the field of geography elicited the following information on this unusual weather pattern.
Contrary to natural pattern, man is helping to change the climate by our activities. For life to continue to go on, you take in oxygen. And how does this oxygen come about? It comes from the plants. Are you getting it? The plants take in the carbon dioxide to manufacture their food, what they call photosynthesis. And when this food is manufactured, they form carbohydrate, maybe cassava, maybe fruits, and so on. And then after the formation of the carbohydrate, the plants give out oxygen into the air. And that oxygen that the plant is giving out into the air maintains the balance so that you can come here and say there is fresh air. What makes it fresh is that the photosynthetic process is yielding oxygen into the atmosphere. And when you breathe it, you say there is fresh air. If all of us are locked up in a room now, within 3 minutes, we'll all die. If you go to any cabinet department now or any wood market, you see that every vegetation in the bush, the natural vegetations are being cut off. As we are doing that, no person is planning of replacing them. This is having a very serious effect on the weather.
With the current global human population estimated to be at over 7 billion, it is obvious that there is a tense competition for the resources on the planet. The unusual weather patterns have been associated with the activity of man on the Earth, and this, apart from damaging the climate, is having adverse effect on the health and well-being of man.
And so what is happening is there is destruction without development. It's not like that. There is even that theory that a plant in your house makes the atmosphere within that environment better. The Earth has been embodied with so many problems that it is crying. And that's why the cry of the Earth is what is affecting us today.
People feel cold, at times they feel hot, at times they say they are dry, at times just because of the weather. It's a funny weather indeed. And you see people coming up with weakness, severe weakness, as a result of one, they have lost so much fluid at night, as a result of excessive sweating. Two, they will be weak because they don't sleep. Three, this will now reduce the immune system. Then some malaria that have been there for some time would suddenly wake up because of drastic reduction in the immunity. And some of them will come out in the morning, weakness, inability to wake up, generalized joint pains. And then it will also be associated with catarrh, whereby have nasal congestion because of dry weather, because associated with dust. Some people that live at the dusty areas, whereby you have so much dust, people moving around, you know. So you have sort of nasal congestion, catarrh, itching in the throat, even in the eye, even in the nose, even in the ears.
Experts have gone ahead to advise on ways to mitigate the negative effects of the harsh weather on human health.
If you are living at the area where there is so much dust, please cover your mouth and your nose with a mask, what we call face mask. You can just wear it temporarily. And then if you are coming back from any place to your house, once you get to your house, wash your face. Then the next thing is to drink enough water. Enough water is very important so that to reduce dehydration that normally comes at night. Then if you are sleeping at night, open the windows, but not so much indeed. Try as much as to open it in a moderate form. Try to eat enough fruits and vegetables. Enough fruit and vegetables will help you to build up your immunity. They build the body against this weather.
Though the wet season is on the way, members of the public must brace up to the challenges of the current weather pattern. Adequate hydration is essential, while proper ventilation at night will help to reduce restlessness, which has been identified as a key outcome of the current heat wave. Emeka Chibu, MCL News.
Diabetes is often described by medical experts as a group of metabolic disease in which a person develops high blood glucose, either because insulin production is inadequate or the body's cell do not respond properly to insulin, or both, is one of the health challenges facing majority of Nigerians today. MCL News highlights the management of diabetes. That's what Richard Gideon tells us more.
Medical report revealed that most common diabetes symptoms include frequent urination, intense thirst and hunger, weight gain and unusual weight loss, as well as male sexual dysfunction, depending on either type 1 or type 2. Speaking on the management of diabetes, Dr. Okochunya advised diabetic patients to adopt a healthy eating habit, engage in adequate exercise, and as well as taking their medications appropriately.
For those who are diabetic, Well, those ones, they have to take their drugs, but I will advise that instead of 3 times a day or 4 times a day, let them go for those ones that you can take once daily. Because excess drugs, especially the painkillers, also affect the pancreas.
Speaking further on how to reduce the high spread of diabetes, respondents called on all relevant arms of government and ministries of health to establish diabetic diagnosis and treatment centers at various health institutions, ensure that medications are readily available and affordable to diabetic patients. This will go a long way in reducing the degenerative effects of the disease on the patients. They also called on well-meaning Nigerians and non-governmental organizations to assist the government in this objective.
Management of diabetes is not as easy as when you're managing typhoid or malaria or even hypertension, because this involves that this person is going to change the diet. This person must start doing some exercise. This person must start taking some drugs. And this person must be on injections. So it's not a question of somebody taking just tablets as is done in hypertension. Management of diabetes is very costly. The government, external institutions must come in. External organizations must come in, because that's the way they are helping the HIV patients. But you see, when you talk of diabetes, it involves those people in the rural areas, those people in the urban areas, children, adults, everybody's involved, even pregnant women, they're all involved now in diabetes. And for you to get and take adequate and current drugs on diabetes, you must have that money. It's costly.
The government has a role to play here. They can subsidize the treatment in terms of the drug and medication and so on. They can even go ahead and have diabetic centers, build one in each geographical zone in Nigeria. We just have 6. Nothing stops them from building a diabetic center in each zone and employ the necessary manpowers and so on. They should encourage the Diabetic Society of Nigeria. There is a diabetic association all over the world, and each country has one. Nigeria has its own, the Diabetic Society of Nigeria. The government should help them, because these are the people that work closely with those who actually have diabetes. And from there, the government can even have a kind of registry for diabetes and get all the facts and so on.
Diabetes is one of the high mortality ailments that is generating concern among Aba residents. Of Rich Ejide, MCL News.
The people of Ndeguru community have praised Governor Kezi Bazo for his developmental strides in the state, especially for considering the community fit for the Abia Mall project. The report.
His Royal Majesty is a Sunday Emejiaka of Ohazu Kingdom, alongside some of his cabinet members and youths who were allotted at what they described as developmental projects of multiplier effect, called on his people to exercise patience with the state government. He appreciated the governor for deeming the community fit for such a gigantic project and endorsed him for 2019. The people noted that the project will not only create employment opportunities for the people, but also improve the socio-economic development of the state. The public-private partnership project will be located at the former Eche Road field, Aba. The development partner, Chiedoze Njoko, assured that the project, which will be delivered in the next 8 months, would be the best across Nigeria.
Governor, okay, so thank you for even giving us the opportunity and the privilege to even come and do it. Then on our own, I'm promising that Check Best will deliver this project in the next 8 months. With the privileged honor of Our Highness and the residents, both landlords and some of the residents, are also in support of what the government is trying to do through us. So we promise we deliver on record time. This arguably will be the most modern shopping plaza east of the Niger when it's done.
On his part, Theophilus Ozozo, Chairman, Stakeholders Association, who explained that the place, which before now was a major security threat, expressed optimism that the project will deal with the issue. He assured of the full cooperation of the people to ensure speedy completion of the project. Chinedu Ayon, a representative of the Private-Public Partnership PPP, the Investment Promotion Office, highlighted that the project is an initiative of the governor to have the private sector assist the government grow the economy of the state. He said a memorandum of understanding for the project have been duly signed between the state government and the development partner.
Kembe ji fence ebe with this zinc. In fact, I'm ike hi ora. Ebo potara gi biko, anya choyi no no here we ghost project. Complete it and we'll give you that cooperation. Ward 11 genye gi ho bele choro.
What we do at PPP is we initiate projects such as this one that is about to start here. We engage with the community. We have a due process platform which enables the investor to be able to get what it is he wants from the project, as well as help the government to generate forms of revenue and the environment, that's the community, to gain from such projects.
The PPP Initiatives project engages the community and also create a due process platform to allow the community generate what it expects of the project, as well as help government generate revenue. Jonah Oje, EMS All News.
As a note, motorbike traders have staged a peaceful protest to the Ogunabo Local Government Area Council to convey their appeal to the state government to give them more time before the demolition of the park. This follows a 7-day quick notice given to them by the state government to vacate the market following the ongoing construction work at Port Harcourt Road. MCLTV News visited the scene on Smooth Arms tells us more.
The protesters could be seen carrying placards with various inscriptions such as "Relocate us before demolition," "Unemployment will increase in Ogunabo." The association, through its leader, Emmanuel Nweke, who read the appeal letter, appealed to the government to give them more time to vacate the park, while the members of the Asanoto Motor Park Traders also appealed to the Abia State government to consider their plea, as they have no alternative or any other place to.
So government
Not shallow log, loga, what the good was. Came by yesterday. Even on Babi, I voted caterpillar bar or Toton defense. Mdad or Sibico. Go for nine. AJG here like it. All I lack one more boy. Mr. Bataran, you're saying, Maka.
A bowl like I could to ascendant Paca Hanona, Ozo dear. Come on, I make a lay okay, doctor, bring our governor. Now, in the Mako in the Erosi Potako Road. Ca on your trying worry. Chotokwane anye banye geno, mwenye kena azwaya nihi, aku tuwe baho, oge nyanye sobo, ma onyuku monyenta.
Responding to the protesters at the council headquarters, the chairman, Ogunabo Local Government Council, Honorable Eze Wanganga, told the traders that the appeal will be conveyed to the appropriate quarters.
Eze okulezi asoso, aye nabatara. mkpesa unu ebibi unu anyị nnabatara ya mkpesa unu unu mkpesara eziokwu anyị ga ite care to the appropriate quarters achọrọkwanụ m imekwa ka unu mara la govona anyị onweghị that bad intention for his people. Kwonwere mbu good intention for his people. And that is the reason oji ma ọdịdị nsuhu ọdọ oji chọwa ịrụwa ọrụwela Port Harcourt Road for the betterment of all of us.
The Asannotu Traders Association is appealing to the Abia State Governor, Dr. Okezie Igbazu, to reconsider the 7-day ultimatum given to them to vacate from the area and extend the time frame, as they have no alternative place to carry out their legitimate business while taking them unawares. They equally appeal to the state government to relocate them to appropriate places before the demolition of the park, as this will not only give them a sigh of relief, but also give them a sense of belonging as law-abiding citizens of Abia State. Ruth Ohams, MCL News.
That was the size of Good Morning Abia package of the news. As Good Morning Abia continues.
Thank you very much, Cynthia, for that news update. We'll go for a break. We'll be back for newspaper reviews. Please stay with us.
Show on TV.
Thank you.
time for us to take a look at the papers this morning, starting with the Daily Sun. Rivers accuses federal government of plot to grant cultist amnesty. Rivers accuses federal government of plot to grant cultist amnesty. That story is on page 3. And the major headline this morning says, Southeast APC to Buhari, give us 2023 presidency. Once national assets named after Ekweme, have not forgotten your sacrifices, President tells Igbo. Story is on page 6. Buhari's second term splits APC in North. Party chieftains won't hold to re-election talks. Story is on page 6. Henchmen and farmers clashes harness a false Osibanjo's committee. That's on page 10. 2019, Ihedioha joins Imo Guba race. 2019, Ihedioha joins Imo Guba race, says I'm well equipped to serve. The story is on page 10 as 8 Libya returnees die, 18 injured in auto crash. The story is on page 34. Okay, the picture element we have on the front page is some of the 2,000 jerrycans of petrol seized from smugglers by Nigeria Customs Service at the creek of Owede Badagry in Lagos yesterday. Fuel crisis. The back page of the Daily Sun this morning, we have on page 46, Jan 2018, Eagles won't take Equatorial Guinea for granted. Coming from Yusuf, Eagles won't take Equatorial Guinea for granted. FIFA and CAF unaware at swearing in. FIFA and CAF unaware at swearing in. Talk about success. It has so many friends. The final story on page 47. Well, you ask who is judged upon where? One-time World Footballer of the Year, sports ambassador of a great nation. Today, he is the president. Well, good thing. Ben Mwabwezi, deadly trap of cattle colonies. Deadly trap of cattle colonies. And here we have the phrase of the president, Buhari. All right, moving down, we meet Citizen Joe. He says, Jonathan remains one of the poorest former Nigerian president. That's the news from Ambassador Egali. Are you his account officer? Well, I guess you have to meet his account officer to find out how much he has in his account before you assume he's the poorest former president. All right, that's it with the Daily Sun.
Okay, the next paper is The Nation. As we continue to wish Nigeria well, on the top left there you can see Enugu's home wears new look for Ekweme. Enugu's home wears new look for Ekweme, and that's the face of a late elder statesman, Alex Ekweme, and that's on page 43 to get know more about that. And it's followed by Amcon in court with Kano over debts. Amcon in court with Kano over debt. Capture that story on page 38, and that's the face of a former Nigerian Eagle. A footballer. All right. 8 Edo Libya returnees die in crash. 8 Edo Libya returnees die in crash. I won't let you down. Where shows Liberians? Please capture this story. And on the Libya returnees that died, we pray that their soul rest in peace. Please capture the stories on page 42 and 4. And leaving doubt, we step down to meet President Muhammadu Buhari with APC Southeast delegation at Presidential Villa in Abuja yesterday. And these you can see very colorful photograph involving our president and the rest of others there. And now down we see two NIA chiefs group as bid to grab $44 million fields. And the banner EFCC vice ex-director general, okay. Disquiet as new bus fire resumes. Please, the story can be continued on page 4. And leaving down to meet Buhari, we are delivering on campaign promises. We are tackling herdsmen's killings. All right, and that story captured also on page 4 a lot. Quite a lot to read up on page 4. And the next day is our picture element. Akwa Ibom State Governor Udom Emmanuel speaking during the state caucus meeting of the PDP, where the governor was endorsed for a second term. With him from second right are Deputy Governor Moses Ebo, Senate Minority Leader Godswill Akpabio, and Senator Albert Akpan. All right, and we go to the last on the front page. Buhari to Southeast APAC leaders. I will give my best to all Nigerians. Buhari to Southeast APAC leaders. I will give my best to all Nigerians. Please capture the story. On page 4, like I said earlier, so much to read up on page 4. And let's quickly go to the back page of The Nation. On the back page, we are meeting today in The Nation from Gabriel Amalu. Gabriel Amalu, the narcissist Avengers are the cows. They have eaten all the shrubs on north, and they are determined to finish all those in the middle and south part of the country. Some even mill up all the way from Central Africa. As is genuinely feared now, they are determined to eat off our country. And this has a lot of idioms and proverbs in there. I'll ask you to decode the meanings there from Gabriel Amalu today in The Nation. And that takes us to Latunji Dare at home abroad, to the Newspapers Proprietors Association of Nigeria. To the Newspapers Proprietors Association of Nigeria. And it's coming from Olatunji at home abroad. I'll ask us to read this column in details and find out what we have in store here for the Newspapers Proprietors Association of Nigeria. And that takes us to Ambassador Oladapo Fafawara. And you can see the picture here. Ambassador Oladapo Fafawara is there. I'll ask you to read up also, because for these columns, there is no peace card from which you can get an insight into what it is talking about. And that takes us to Hardball. We are meeting Hardball this morning, winning business line. And what could this winning business line be? Unless you read up the back page of The Nation, you will now get to know what. And we go to Ripples. Remember Ripples, the cartoon that says it all in a comic way. PDP's call for Ambode's ban, ridiculous, says group. PDP's call for Ambode's ban, ridiculous. Scared of 2019, cowards die many times before they are dead. All right, thank you very much. Baba takes us to the next.
All right, New Telegraph is the line, but not the least. Says tax, FIRS generates record 4 trillion naira in 1 year. Agriculture tops employment chart, engages 32.35 million. All right, stepping down, we meet Libya. 8 Libya legionnaires die in road crash. That's on page 9. Federal government's administrative panel grill suspended SEC DG Guazo. That's on page 5. Kidnappers abduct rape son and kill 6 villagers. Files read it up on page 9. Why IMF raises Nigeria's 2018 growth forecast. It's on page 30. 2019 PDP targets APC governors, senators for presidency. There's article Shekara Lamido McAfee, Dankombo on the cards. Southeast APC leaders endorse Buhari for re-election. Find the story on page 2. How customs officers conspired to smuggle 661 rifles into Nigeria coming from DSS. And alcohol in late teens increases liver disease risk in adulthood. That health is on page 6. But the picture element is that of a soccer star, judge of where becomes 24th Liberian president. Making history. That's on page 36. Well, he started his dream a long time ago, and today he's the president of Liberia. Talk about dreams and his fulfillment. Well, consistency should be the order of the day. All right, let's take our attention to the back page of the New Telegraph. Here, first we meet on Marvel. Say the world must be made safe for democracy. Each piece must be planted upon the tested foundations of political liberty. The world must be made safe for democracy. His peace must be planted upon the tested my foundations of political liberty, which will say, claim agree what a country. Go to page 14 and read up this article, what a country. Now, Kasim Afogbeha's stomach infrastructure in politics. Truth is sacrilege. Morality is a sin. And we have the faces of the president and that of Benue State Governor Buhari and Otom. Now, a bit of the article, he says, it offends good judgment for any president to play politics when the nation is at a crossroad on a number of fronts, when the people are wailing, when their tears are flowing endlessly like river lakes, when their emotions are finished and their stomachs are hungry. All right, that is it on the papers. This morning, just a tip of the iceberg. We expect you to visit your vendor and pick any of the national dailies. So much to read up, Cynthia. From the Daily Sun to the Nation, then to New Telegram. That's interesting and, you know, catchy headlines. And if you look at the new, the Daily Sun, the front page, the jerrycans, talking about 22,000 jerrycans of fuel. You know, by smugglers. It's about if you can't do anything for us, let us try to do it for ourselves. Well, if there's no fear in filling stations, that's what they tell us. But you look at this jerrycan being used to smuggle this same fuel that we're saying is scarce out of this very country. And look at where they caught them, at the creek of Owede Badagry. You know where Owede is? Owede is almost heading out of, going to Benin, that's Cotonou. That is selling what we are looking for here in those neighboring countries. Well, you know what it means? They want to make profit. And we're still talking about scarcity of this very product in this nation.
You know, yesterday we were talking about the security, the very, the security of Nigeria is failing us. And we know we have customs, we have so much people that we've employed and being paid by taxpayers' money to guard the country inside out. But when we hear these kind of things, then it still goes down to tell us that those people who put there are not doing anything. I mean the borders.
That's right. No, before some of these things are done, there's a collabo. They collaborate with the security people. I don't know how often you've been to that over there, as we see. Most people use cement, some use over there. They are border towns. Mm-hmm. Right? So before you can cross, either you're leaving or you're coming into this area. There are security, personnel there. And if you see what they do, oh, God help
us. That's another business.
Everybody wants to be poor. I mean, you need to go there.
Just
like having policemen, man roadblocks. It's just the same thing.
Exactly. I've been there once.
It's just the same thing from start to finish.
Money exchanging hands and gifts, items.
And funny enough, most of them don't even want you to approach them with your passport. They want you to just cross and give them money. So, whatever you do, that you want, it's up to you. Now, this jerrycans, you want to tell me that it's all the business started yesterday?
No, of course it's not.
It has always been there. But the thing is that maybe because people are not talking and they feel they cannot always, they can use this to, either twist the minds and brains of some people. But it has always been there. There has always been this smuggling. There have always been black market. But the question you ask yourself, well, how come all that have been done trying to, either cut off or curtail the excesses of the smugglers, most times, yields no result. Because there are people in the inside giving them the go ahead.
It's quite disheartening. Mm-hmm. But this, I really, really wonder what really happened in this, about this particular one that they now decided to bring to the open. What about the previous ones that they refused?
We'll always have scapegoats.
All
right. That's just the truth.
Continue.
Have you asked yourself why? So, okay, where some of this oil pump ends, the tankers, when they come, you talk about diversions.
Exactly.
Most of these are diverted products. They have to sell it at a high margin to make profit. Now imagine when that fuel scarcity first hit us. Some people bought fuel at 140, 141 naira because it was still being sold at 145. Some at 142. But the moment they heard that there's going to be scarcity, they locked up their stations. A lot of them, very many of them, they only to start selling that fuel at 250, 300 in this same country.
And that pops up the question again, how, where do we go from here? Even as we continue praying for one particular ugly incident, the next day another one pops up.
I've always asked you, and I've always said, the problem with us is that we are praying too much. We should stop praying and act. I mean, God is not going down, not going to come down from heaven, drag us by the neck and make us do some of these things. We need to have that will power. We need to say, this is what we're going to do. You know, the truth is that we'll not be having good representations or representatives out there. We've not been having it. We've not been having people that represent this nation and not their families.
At all.
We don't have people that represents, you know, our background. The core values of this very society is being destroyed on a daily basis, and nobody cares to say anything about it. We don't care to tell the people that it is not the way it should be. How many of us will have the boldness to call some of these representatives at various houses and say, you're not getting it right? But now, representing the people is not just about digging boreholes.
Even when you do, will that your voice count?
Oh, no, sure, God, sure, will count. Let me tell you how. What we're saying here counts. We are talking here, somebody's hearing.
They
listen every day. When we shouted about Fox Road, it was handled. Mm-hmm. We shouted about Park Road, it was handled. Talked about Bata, it was handled. Mm-hmm. Because somebody's listening. Mm-hmm. And we keep talking. You keep bringing people. We keep doing what we have to do. We keep going up.
I'm saying you're not doing well, Mr. Okeke.
Let me tell you why
you're
not representing
us well.
No, let me tell you how it works.
All right.
Now, you're going to say that you're not representing us well. You're telling that person, you're telling us. I'm close there, and I heard it, the world have heard it. Once I hear such things, the world will hear it. Because I will say it from this platform. I say it from anywhere. Even being part of the movement, I try to always let them know that this is the way it should be done. And do it the right way. If you don't do it the right way, I come out to say that you're not doing it the right way. So we need to have that very mind. People should come to that point where we look these people to the face and tell them you're not doing it right. You know why most people will not say that?
Tell me.
When you totally depend on them, when your every dependence is on these people that goes to represent us.
And that is, you're talking about mediocrity and sycophants.
I don't know what you want to call it, but you end up mortgaging your own conscience.
That is it.
You end up selling it to them. You end up not coming out to say things the way it ought to be said.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're able, by the time we get to that level, I've always asked myself, how did most developed countries get to where they are today? Was it by praying? Or was it by taking action? I think the latter is the answer.
Mm.
They decided to take action. They decided to do things the way it ought to be done.
Take action and still pray.
Yeah. Well, I've not said you won't pray. I've not said we don't have to pray. But there are some of these things we do.
We do more of action than of prayers. Is that what you're saying? Or the two of them should go pari passu?
Well, pray without work.
Yeah, it's nothing.
You do not
think that works. Yeah.
God needs to see you initiate,
take a step of action.
Initiate something. And now, assuming you stay in the house and you keep asking God to bless you, without venturing into anything, will God bless you? No. God doesn't bless anybody. I have never seen God. If I went to people say, God bless me, I get pitched up. God doesn't bless anybody. God blesses the works of our hands. If you stay in the house and sleep all through, man, I won't find out from heaven. I think the day he did was when God was still trying to perfect the world and do things, through the journey, in the wilderness. There's not going to be such thing.
So again. What you're saying is our country, our leaders, as much as we want to pray, want them to take a step of action and begin to, redress as situations.
You stay in your home, you want to pray, you stay in churches and keep praying and keep telling God, I want you to change this society, but you don't have your PVC.
Like many don't. Most Christians don't.
They will tell you that there are some churches that believe in politics. They don't vote.
They don't vote.
So tell me, what are you doing in your church praying for God to change the
nation? Who will use if you don't?
Okay, assuming one of you, everybody is like you, who will vote? So when you do some of this, we need to think. We need to come out of this mental slavery. of thinking that God is going to come down from heaven, walk the roads of Nigeria and the roads of Abia and Aba and make things good. No, God isn't going to do that.
And I think that also applies to the issue of defense, security that we have in Nigeria, in individual states.
Definitely.
Like, we must have to do something about our security.
If every state decides to do what Ekiti State governor did in Ekiti State, I identify as a I mean, result will just take you just turn around quickly. But do you know what it is?
He got the hunters involved in it. But how many do we still have hunters?
What are you talking? You can develop some. If you don't have it, it's either something is inborn or you acquire it as a knack. If it's not inborn, you still have that provision of acquiring it as a knack. Now, if you don't have it, you provide it. Do you know how many people jobless youth that will be ready to become hunters overnight? Then you also have arrangement in place to check some of them, check the excesses. That's what Ayodele have been able to achieve in Ekiti State. And that's why the federal government, he gave a standing order. When you see all these people around to Balosa, shoot. And when you know that there's a standing order to shoot, you won't even approach because you can also get killed. But it's only in all those shibboleth states where people are not willing, ready to take action. Well, stay in your mosque, stay in the churches and keep praying and let arms fall from heaven and fight one another. Okay, that's the way to go. Except the best bullet we have, the best gun everybody will have these days is our voter's card. You have your voter's card. Vote in those you think will help. Vote, remove those you feel that have not done anything. I think we should start preaching it from the pulpits. We should preach it wherever we go. Exactly. We should let people know that time has come that we should change some of these things. All right, Cynthia, I think we should leave it here and move on to other segments of this very program. I want to thank you, our viewers, for being part of this very newspaper review. All we've just done here is a tip of the iceberg. Visit your vendor, pick the New Telegraph, find out the headline says 2019 PDP targets APC governors, senators for presidency, and those in line. Then, I didn't even say this, Cynthia. This picture, George Weah, being sworn in as Liberian president.
Mm-hmm. From the football pitch.
From the football pitch.
To
the presidential villa.
That's wonderful.
After how many years?
It's quite encouraging.
Very, very. Mm-hmm. I think we should encourage such and hope that so doing all our, it's not just the sportsmen, we should also have those in the entertainment industry. We also call that one entertainment too.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Try to come out to help us change our society. If you just act it in the movie, we probably have to act it for it.
Exactly.
All right, that's it. We'll go for a break. We'll be right back. And the program will continue with our discussion segment. Please stay with us.
Show on TV.
Have you heard of Presco World and Heaven Options Limited? Presco is a home of the red image right here in Aba. Why go to Lagos or Port Harcourt for your direct image jobs? Come to Presco World and Heaven Options located at number 145 Azikiwe Road, Aba for perfect cover page, journals, magazines, brochures and flyers. We also offer printing services in digital flex and billboard, window graphics, posters, stickers, heat transfers, ID cards, complimentary cards, monogram and car branding. Heaven Options offer you entertainment services like event management, ambulance services with well-dignified undertakers. We can also boast of 3 months ordinary program in computer training, 6 months certificate in computer training, and 1 year advanced certificate in computer training. Why not visit Presco and experience that quality jobs? For inquiries, call 080-33-22-6115, 070-40-24-7196, 070-84-69-8165.
Do not deface Abia State with posters. Do not defecate on our streets. Do not litter Abia State.
My brothers, I say, what did man go do for this world where people not go talk? If you chop,
do not urinate in public places.
You no chop, then go talk. What did make you do for this world? I say, make we go do the things where we carry for house. Now so world wonder. Have you not been so?
Keep Abia State clean. This message is brought to you by MCL TV.
Show on TV.
Chukwu nenye kari onye obula. Chukwu nenye kari onye obula. Onenye kandoru beke neri bege. Nonwa nonwa. Onenye o. Onenye o. Onenye o.
Hello, my name is Buchi. Keep watching MCL TV and don't go away.
Aye, God has given you victory. Aye, He has given you victory. Aye, God has given you victory. Aye, He has given you victory. What's up, people? It's your boy, E-Ben, ministering to God's children. And you're watching MCL TV. Don't touch that dial. Peace. I love you.
MCL, the word in your home.
For hawkers of different goods to convert street corners to places of business, while some others have perfected the art of shoveling through slow-moving traffic, all in a bid to exchange one item or the other for money on the street of Aba. These traders are often exposed to danger through motor accidents, while the danger of being crushed by vehicles is also ever present with them. It is not uncommon for some to blame the situation on the lack of adequate shops and stores to accommodate traders in existing markets in the city.
I will advise them to be more careful against accident.
more especially motor accident.
Some of them are not just refusing to stay. Some of them, because of, you know, because of the poverty in Nigeria, everybody wants to make money so they can feed. So to some of them, the easy way is to just come out to the streets, which is not still safe.
The street trading is not well done because that does not help a country to rest. The government is supposed to take care of all those people.
Like this market is money market. So they always, it's a road market, trading market. They don't have, some of them don't have shade actually.
Some market union officials who spoke to MCR News said they have often appealed to their members to stop trading on the streets, while some appealed to the state government to provide affordable shops in the markets.
Government can build shops, you know, assist people trading on the roadside, because most of those people don't have capital to rent shop.
Look at how this place is, the shade. We built it by ourselves, and the people that built it didn't construct the thing very well. So we want government to come and help those places, those small structures to be nice.
They don't supposed to do so. They need to go inside the market, and government will prepare a place for them so that they will stay there and trade.
So I was thinking government should help at least in shifting some of them out, because it has caused a lot of issues. So I think it should be really discouraged or taken to the market area, not in the roadside or not in the urban civilized side.
The efforts of the government to bring sanity to the streets is a continuous exercise. More needs to be done in the area of public education on the dangers associated with the street trading.
Like the leather and garment industries, the carpentry cluster of
in Ugunaba local government area. While this road constructed several years back has failed at various parts, reconstruction efforts has either been abandoned or fizzled out after a brief start.
Since almost a year now, bad market because of bad roads.
The very fertile outskirts of rural towns of Obohia and others serve as a food basket to Aba, and they have had to convey their commodities through this very rough and failed road, with the result of accidents, losses of their products, and severe inconvenience on a daily basis. Lamenting their plight, the traders were filled with emotions on how their predicament can be addressed. They appealed for the government's attention to ease their suffering.
So then I woke up. Government weekend cheto boya because boya emeze oga dry man oga mekwenu people ihe weekend na aga because o mama de bela ma e belile nwe short e nwe bana minute ona nwe ze shaga patara so ina yoka government weekend patara e ya nwa uza kai we bolike weekend na rekwana aga ya weekend na aga o ma de bia e nwe oga ere
ate e ba ibi ina na take school down have so on ina ya ti na your government doctor oke si ba si ya biko.
Government ya biko obu ahia chore enyemaka ha gbatara anyi oso awona ha ka cho ka edere ndu arewala mi ikpere buwele mi mmiri negwu eba obu ha cho ka edere ndu gawa nihu ha bia ruora ayo obu ha biko.
One good fact remained, that they equally expressed appreciation of the present government effort and pray that the area receive attention soon. The area Obohia has a great phobia for the rains, as it is during the rains that they experience the worst of hard times with flooding and associated ailments. If Obohia is repaired, a reputable source of cheap food, vegetable and fruit supply line would have been open to Aba urban residents. Marvelous Chukwuma, MCL Grassroots Reports.
Agriculture can help Nigeria to diversify its economy through shifts from a monocultured economy moving from over-reliance on crude oil, especially at a time when oil price is falling. It will also help in the provision of food and raw materials from the Nigerian population and the development of the manufacturing sector.
Agriculture is the biggest means by which we can employ people. The youths can be employed, because it's self-sustaining and everybody can feed on it. Everybody can start it on his own. So there's no other means whereby the youth can be employed more than agriculture.
Many countries of the world get their youth employed in agriculture, and agriculture is the main source of food to everybody. Agriculture is mainly a source of living, and whoever that, you know, engages in agriculture, you know, in one way or the other, has secured employment, in one way or the other, has secured food security, and so on and so forth.
I think the government of the day is placing much emphasis on agriculture, and more especially this time around, that we are facing economic recession and where we are having a lot of unemployment. Agriculture definitely will prove to be a veritable ground for employment for the unemployed youths.
Nigeria is a net importer of consumables, which Nigeria is capable of producing for local consumption and for exports.
As you know, the president of this country has commanded everybody to go into agric, because all these agricultural products are being brought before from overseas. But today, we are producing them here, and we are now expecting to extend them out. It will be a very big means of foreign exchange for what I see by next year. If government can reach out to the people directly, all the farmers, you take their names, you go to their farms, give them what they need to make this ends meet, it will be okay.
The white collar jobs are no more there, and employment doesn't come easy, but you can also be self-employed by engaging in agriculture, especially in animal, you know, farming. The little you have, the little your friends or your relatives can afford, you can start up something. This poultry thing, you don't need to start big. You don't need all the money in the world for it to start. You can start very small. That's always my advice.
The government has to make the environment, you know, safe and attractive to, you know, prospective farmers. The government is not helping matters. You know, there are a lot of things that government can provide to make agriculture thrive. Those things are not available. Instead, the government seems to become a bottleneck to people who want to get into agriculture. You can't get farm implements, you can't get so-called tractors. The tractors they showcase on the television are only seen on the television. You can't see it real. So, and the cost of fertilizer is really affecting farmers. Many people cannot afford a bag of fertilizer. If there is any place government can talk about subsidy, it should be on farming.
The importance of agriculture to the Nigerian economy for wealth creation, employment, food security, and foreign exchange cannot be overemphasized. If proper investments are made in the agricultural sector, the contributions made to the economy by this sector can be increased. Nigeria has both the human and natural resources to harness this potential.
Morning Abia, your one-stop breakfast show on TV.
Do not deface Abia State with posters. Do not defecate on our streets. Do not litter Abia State.
My brothers, I say, what did man go do for this world where people not go talk? If you chop,
do not urinate in public places.
You no chop, then go talk. What did man go do for this world? I say, make we go do the things where we carry for hands. Now so world want that. I be not been so.
Keep Abia State clean. This message is brought to you by MCL TV.
Show on TV.
Thank you.
One Stop Breakfast Show on TV. Show on TV.
Welcome back. It's still your One Stop Breakfast program on MCL TV. Good morning. We are welcoming you to our discussion segment this morning. The beauty of democracy, they say, is opposition. Well, a state that has one state, one party will not really do well when it comes to democracy. Now, in a democratic setting, there has to be voices heard from several quarters that will be able to oppose the ruling party by simply bringing out the best of that very party. In Nigeria today, we have APC as the ruling government, like we had PDP before. Before APC came on board, they were seem to be the opposition party, but today they are the ruling party. The former ruling party PDP have now come to be opposition party as well as other political parties. But are we really practicing politics of opposition in Nigeria? How well are we doing here? If we are doing well, how strong is the opposition parties to be able to still position this very nation called Nigeria in the right path of democracy? Now this morning we're going to be looking at what seems to be happening in all the other political parties that seem to be in opposition, from PDP to other parties, especially the former ruling party, the PDP.
And that we are going to discuss with Emmanuel Sowa, who is also in the very heart of the opposition party, we call PDP, in the person of Barrister St. Moses, who is organizing secretary for PDP. Sir, good morning, welcome.
Good morning.
Welcome to the program. It's good to have you with us today. You are the state organizing secretary of PDP at your state.
Yes.
And you did attend the last PDP convention. And you came back here and told us that PDP is back. That was the way you said it. You know, you said, let me use your word correctly, you said the house is okay again and PDP is ready for 2019. That was exactly what you told us, and said it's now repositioned to take back its position. But of late, we don't seem to be seeing things that agree with that your assertion the last time, because we seem to have a certain group led by Prince Emamusu that feels that that there's division, or that there's a breakaway in PDP, and as such, that PDP is not one, as you made us believe when you came back from Abuja. Is that true?
Well, I do not think there is a break in PDP. There is no faction in PDP. There is no group that is claiming to be PDP. What we have is one indivisible People's Democratic Party. After the convention, everything went smoothly. We were able to elect a national chairman in the person of Secondus. We had all the other offices of the party that were elected. And ever since then, we have not had any cause to believe that there is a breakaway from PDP. Many people may be aggrieved over what, when they fail to, you know, win whatever position they contested for. They are free to be aggrieved. They are free to show their anger in whatever form or manner. It has for PDP, we have one. I am aware there is one that called itself Fresh PDP. That's a new name. But there's nothing like Fresh PDP in Nigeria. We have People's Democratic Party. If there is a Fresh PDP, maybe they are looking for recognition, or may go for registration by INEC. But what we have recognized in Nigeria is People's Democratic Party. There is nothing like fresh PDP.
Okay, Barrister, you said that the organizing secretary, the state organizing secretary for PDP, you said that there's no other group, but it's on record here that the Board of Trustees BOT of the People's Democratic Party, PDP, on Sunday said it played a very good role in the decision of a splinter group to call the Fresh PDP and collapse into the mainstream. And at a statement by the media said that the BOT chairman by name, Senator Waleed Jibrin, noted that the group was constantly in touch with the new and the various organs of the party in a couple of weeks ago. And the BOT, which is the Board of Trustees and the national leadership of the party, Jibrin said that the national leadership of the party are very well in touch and involved and also played a great role in the dissolution of the Fresh PDP, recently formed by some aggrieved members of the party. How can you explain that?
Yes, people went and formed Fresh PDP. It is not a faction of PDP. It's like when we had all Nigerian People's Party and the Nigerian People Party. You can't say there is a faction in that. All Nigerian People's Party is a party of itself.
If all is well, why would there be formation of?
They will continue bringing people back. Those who are aggrieved. What I'm quarreling about is the word faction. It's not a faction. They are a group that formed Fresh PDP. Fresh PDP is a name different from...
From where?
From PDP. You are free to even call your own Black PDP if you go and form. You form it. You nurture it.
From where?
If it grows, it grows.
From where, sir?
Nobody can come from the blues. You must come from somewhere. It's either you belong to APC or you belong to PDP. If you, even the new mushroom parties that were registered the other day, they came from parties and formed their own. They weren't people from the marketplace. They were people from a party that now felt they needed their own party. They started as an association. And from an association, they applied to be become a party. And once they satisfy the requirement, it is not the same thing as faction. If you look at what happened during Ahmadu Sharif and the McAfee group factions, that was rightly faction. Ahmadu Sharif said, "I am PDP." McAfee says, "I am PDP." They never coined anything in their names. What they were struggling was for the soul of PDP. That is faction. But in this case, these people left, formed their own group, we call it Fresh PDP. It's not PDP. Because they left, okay, those people who left PDP and they merged as APC, are they faction? They're not faction. They're still APC. Even though 90% of them came from PDP, they are now designing their own, moving.
When you talk about designing their own and whatever that goes with that, their party, yeah, you agree that they've left completely and they don't want to come back. But in this situation, we have a case where they use the same logo of PDP. They use the motto of PDP. Everything about them is PDP.
That is an impersonation.
I'm sorry. Let me just come here before you give us the answer. If it is impersonation, why? I think the PDP should have reacted before even now.
If the negotiation had failed, you will see the reaction. Because when you register a logo, it's like having a copyright in your logo. You are authorized to use that logo. You don't, under any guise, change your name and use the same logo. No, no, no. That will be deceiving the people. What PDP is doing is to use the massage oil to massage them, to see that they come back. Not they are forming a faction of PDP. No, 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 it's not true.
Okay, now,
provided they use that name, Fresh. Fresh PDP is not the same thing as PDP.
Can you tell us this? I want to ask you this question openly so that our viewers, I'm sure, who are also worried for specific reasons, may have also asked this very question. And let's see if we'll be able to get the answer. Ever since PDP lost the 2015 election, there has been a lot of controversies.
Yes.
There has been a lot of controversy. Is it that PDP is finding it hard to settle with the fact of losing an election and regrouping to fight back, or that they've allowed themselves to now be used and not be able to be that very voice again that should give the people that strong voice of opposition?
You know, PDP was in power for
16 years.
16 years,
sure.
And that made a lot of people, the group in PDP, very powerful. So powerful that what they say becomes, if they say let there be light, it becomes light. Now they have gone into opposition. It is not easy to wear off that power. You see, that the system of imposition nearly became a tradition in PDP. The same thing that is happening in APC. That is why APC finds it difficult to get themselves organized. Because that same imposition is there. To wear it off is not easy. So when PDP now went into opposition and carried the same imposition along and saw the damage it has been causing, the train followed. They are now soft pedaling to see that whether it can wear off imposition and impunity. And by the grace of God, before 2019 primaries, it will totally be won back.
All right.
Now, it's better to realize where your problems are. And I think PDP has learned that. That the only problem they are suffering now is imposition and impunity. And everybody is singing it, we must do away with it.
All right, that is good you answered that question, because it's been a source of worry to a whole lot of people, given that what we want and what we also know as the beauty of democracy is opposition. When it's not there, well, there's no opposition. It will be one party state. And you know what that, you know, the world befalls on a nation that is practicing such. Okay, we'll go for a break. We'll be right back, and the phone lines will be open so that you can be part of this discussion. Don't go.
Show on TV. one-stop breakfast show on TV.
You're welcome back. It's still your one-stop breakfast program. My name is CEO TV. Good morning. We're still discussing controversies as fresh PDP denies reconciliation. But the state organizing secretary of PDP, Abia State, Barrister Sam Moses Obuna, has said there is no such thing as controversy, that there is no such thing as another group, that it's just a few people that feel that group. But I want to ask Sam Moses, before we went on that very break, you had said something like the party haven't recognized where their problem is or what the problem is, and where to also get in and be able to nip it to the board that they are ready for 2019. Don't you think also to a large extent that sometimes conflict helps to strengthen a people?
Yes, before, even when God wants to strengthen things, he brings in conflict. There must be conflict for us to move ahead, or for you to realize where you are. If you have things smooth without people voicing out where you are wrong, right? You may think all is well, always intact, when in fact always not intact. Remember when College Obi, always intact. When the election came, College Obi lost and found out that Olu wasn't intact. You see, that is why these days you find people in leadership resenting to dissent voices. You see, everybody, anybody who calls you to say you have a good people on your face, it's your friend. Because it becomes a mirror.
You used to see yourself.
You used to see yourself.
Okay.
Because you can't see your face. Nobody sees his face. So that person who points out what can make people laugh at you. Instead of you bringing him close, what they do is to, they don't want to see you, they push you aside. Those of us who are very uncomfortable when things are going wrong, wouldn't bother, because I will be failing in my duty if I see you are doing things wrong. And I fail to tell you, when I know the failure, when it finally comes, all of us will suffer it.
That's right.
All right.
Yes, but I think that the controversy, if you call it controversy, PDP, is to strengthen the feeling that impunity and imposition will damage whatever hinder us from having the success we
need. Anyway, thank you, Barrister. But we all know that an opposition that is not very strong, or that's somewhat weak on one leg or the other, will find it difficult to really wrestle power from a very strong existing or incumbent government. And at this point, that is what I want you to tell us. If you think that the PDP, with all this inside water boiling within, is ready to wrestle power from APC come 2019.
Yes, we are ready to wrestle power. Very, very ready. That's why we are hammering. The only little problem we have is this problem of impunity, where somebody will sit down in his house because he's a senator, or maybe because he's a powerful member of the party. You sit down in your house and they list out those you think will be delegates. Then you impose it on the party so that those delegates will file behind you and make you whatever you think you want to become. You think others will just sit down and watch? And the only option for them is to say, okay, you become the candidate, but you cannot win. All of them will support an opposing party. That's why PDP has been failing. Not that PDP is not strong. PDP is very strong. As a democratic party, when you allow the voice of the people to choose who to represent them, you see, everybody will work towards the success of that person. But the situation you shun the popular voice and impose a person upon them, a person they have said in their vote power, voting power, they don't like, you refuse, because you have a voice in the party, because you are powerful, because you have money, because you are a leader. Then, like I was said, if the rich are mighty, first to write justice with black ink on white paper, the poor and downtrodden will wait for you and write the same justice with their blood and the sword. And what does it yield? Katakata.
Well, that katakata you just mentioned is one thing that also a lot of people is worried about, as it has to do with our politics in Nigeria now. Suppose it's PDP, we can't stop discussing it because they govern this nation for 16 years. And I am sure they have a lot of experience. I'm also sure, having been the ruling party, should be in a better position to be the opposition voice without mixing words, saying it the way it is. Knowing if what they did when they did it was right, and they feel that things that have been done now is not being done right, they should be able to give us that voice. I think that's also why people are looking up to them. But I want to ask you this question. Inside, a house that is divided within itself can never stand. There has been this insistent struggle in PDP for some time now that have denied them that position they ought to be playing, or the role they ought to be playing in the advancement of this very nation democratically. Now, haven't the party considered all this and at least for once shield the sword and do the service to the nation that they ought to do? Because it's about individuals. You did make a statement. You said develop people with so powerful that their word becomes law. Now, can't we drop such attitudes, such mentality?
That is why the present chairman of the party, Uchese Kondus, says those era of impunity are over. And we pray, as the organizing secretary in Abia State, we are seeing the same, that the period of impunity will soon be over. And the only test is the next primaries that will come.
You use the word will, sir. You didn't say is, you said will.
Yes, you can only know that it is over when the test comes. And somebody will try to crash through the window. And we effectively block him. If we effectively block him, then he will know that it is now you should see the party as democratic. You see the members of the party as relevant to making what you want to be. If you shun the members of the party and do things anyhow, and think that when the time comes you just to use your money and buy everybody, you may be making a mistake. Because it is within this period the party you are leading hopes on you to look at them, strengthen their faith in you, strengthen their hope in you, strengthen that they will now stand like Ruth and begin to sing, when you die, we die. When you are buried, we are buried. Because they have hope that when you finally become what you aspire to become, they will be part and parcel of it. But if you shun them and leave them, and you never yield to their cries, you never yield to their problems when they call upon you, then the primaries come. Then you lose money and your power to bribe a few people, and they make you a candidate. Those who will vote for you is okay. You are not our choice. Like the Ngwa man, you say, Kamajishi, Nkobo, they are prepared to burn the whole of their firewood to make sure that thing they want will be actualized, including voting for your opponents. That is why PDP has seen it. I said, no, we need a popular candidate who will be supported by members of the party. So if you want to be a candidate of the party, come back and massage the party now. Build the party now. Do things that people will see and say, surely, this person is doing it. Don't rely on what will happen at the general election. No. First of all, rely on what will happen at the primaries. Right. Because it is the primaries well conducted that will lead your success at the general election.
All right. Thank you very much, Barrister Moses. You are the organizing secretary for PDP, their state. And at this point, that is why I want to shift this question now to this direction. It is said that we have party supremacy, that one man is not supposed to be supreme, more supreme than the party's ideal and all that. But we see, it's been said that Uche Sekondo was posted by Wike, and many other things are happening in the party. Do you think, at this point, that this will help sustain the peace we have in?
Who said Uche Sekondo was hosted on the party by Wike? I was there at the
You know, we discussed this here on this platform.
Yes, now it was not true. I said it is not true. Sekondus is an experienced person. He has been in the party. He has been at the leadership of the party. He knows where the roof is leaking. PDP says, okay. Delegates went to the convention and said, we are going to face a formidable opponent. We don't need somebody who will be playing hide and seek. Let us use somebody who is experienced, who will not begin to learn and begin to find out where the party properties are hidden. He will be busy looking for the party and the election will be over. Let's use a man who knows what to do and not a man who will begin to learn. That's why everybody voted for Second News. Those people who are talking about unity list and all that list, they were other lists. We call it lineup. In every delegate election, there must be lineup. If you had the wrong lineup and their lineup didn't go, you cannot say you lose popular people to form a popular lineup. If you are forming a lineup and you lose mediocres, you won't sell through.
You need to use experience.
Experienced people.
Yeah.
And if you look at the team people that are with Sekondus now, you will see that they are experienced people. Let's not look at Cornelia Kopondo. Is he a mediocre in this game? Assuming where you have a material like Cornelia Kopondo, you go and queue him behind another person who is a mediocre. And if you look at their lineup, there is nobody there. Who will vote for them? So it is a lineup thing. It is not a hoist. It is everywhere, even at the bar election. There are lineups.
Okay, Pastor, how is the party funded? Is it by the governor or?
No, I think we should look at it this way. Who is the leader of the party? Right. Now, who is the leader of
the nomenclature?
Like, when you look, I want to give, let's have it this way, please. If the president is of the, okay, like the president now, who is the leader of the party, APC government?
Yes.
Is it the president or
Oyeku? Is the president.
Okay, now when you come down to Abia State, who is the leader of PDP? Is it the chairman of the party or the government?
The word leadership is a nomenclature.
I didn't say leader.
It is unconstitutional. It's not in the constitution.
Okay.
The constitution does not have a position called leader. No. We have chairman of the party down. And when you talk about the supremacy of the party, the bulk ends at the chairman. Who is the head of the, in the case of Abia State, SWC. In the case of the
national
level, you have NWC. That is National Working Committee and State Working Committee. The chairman is the head. And it is that group that has the financing, except it is what will be going amendment of constitutions and things like that to drag it to the convention. All right? We also have the caucus, where the leader of the party heads. All right? So, when you come to this leadership, it is a respect to the chief executive. You can't just, because party is supreme, you will say that they are nobody's. No. They are the leaders of the party in their various states, not to take over the functions of the party, the constitutional functions of the party officers, executives. Okay? As a leader of the party, he is there to rescue the party if the party has any problem. because he is the chief executive, the number one citizen of that state or of the nation, who ought to be number one at everything, not to take over the function. So nobody should be scared about who is the leader of the party and who is not the leader of the party. Like in Abia State, with due respect, Dr. Ibazi is the leader of the party in Abia State. And the party runs to him whenever we have crisis, something we cannot handle in the party. We seek his advice.
How about funding?
Party funds it. It is the party that funds itself.
Okay.
It is not the chief executive.
All right.
There's not. You remember that the moment Okezie Ibazu becomes the governor, he becomes the governor of PDP, governor of APC, governor of Abga, governor of every citizen in Abga. And he ought not to discriminate in whatever he does, because he has sworn an oath to protect the constitution. He must operate according to the dictates of the constitution. That's why, except the party goes runs to him for help, he cannot come to carry the party. He cannot carry the party because the party is supreme. He is under the party. He is not above the party.
Okay.
So, yeah, you are saying, finally, yeah, because time is no more on our side, you are saying that PDP today is ready to play.
Right. If you come to Abia State, you will see that PDP is strong. Ready. It's like Union Bank.
Ready to wrestle power.
Strong. Reliable. If you look at the way Okezie Ibazu is going on infrastructure,
big, strong, reliable.
You will see that he is there to win over the grassroots. I don't think there is a strong voice today that will begin to say, Okezie did this, I know the PDP is not taking care of the problems of the masses. No. He has seen where the problems are. The greatest problem we have in Abia is the problem of infrastructure, and he has hammered it headlong. The problem of the salary, by the grace of God, he is handling it as the funds
come. The two, which one is more important?
Both.
Which one? Everyone must have your back.
Listen.
Salary of workers and that of infrastructure.
Listen, let me tell you. If you dwell on salary of the workers alone without looking at the infrastructure, you will be helping people who are well fed, who cannot move.
Yeah.
Now, if you hammer on infrastructure without the salary, you will have beautiful roads with people who are so hungry that they can't also move. That is why both must be balanced.
Attended.
I always tell that when God created heaven and earth, that is the things inside heaven and earth, he stopped on Thursday. Left. People say he stopped on Friday. It's not true. He stopped on Thursday, created everywhere, and left. When he saw that he needed people to appreciate what he has created, on Friday he went back and said, come back, oh! If you read the Bible, he said, come, let us create man in our image. The people he was asking to come were the people who created the world with him, who had left. So in everything you do, there must be sound mind to appreciate it. Otherwise, you will be thinking that the people that ought to appreciate you are not appreciative. So that is why I think the headache the governor has now, that's why he created a panel, a committee, to make sure that this salary palaver will not reoccur. So that as he is balancing the infrastructures, he will also balance, feed the people right, who will appreciate.
Which is a little to the left, a little to the right.
Beautiful.
Which was also why the same Jesus you preached and God as he did things, when the disciples said, let us send these people home, he said, first of all, feed them.
Beautiful. And that is what Okezie is doing now. By the time the months will run, you will see that this problem of salary,
it will be a thing of the past.
And by then, all the eyes that will look at the infrastructure he's building will have been fed, and they will be so happy and glad. And the only thing you'll be hearing is OVI. OVI.
Well, what we actually want to hear is a voice at the national level telling the government at the center do things the way it ought to be done. They call it opposition, and today they say PDP is the only voice of opposition we have among all the political parties. So we want them to be strong so that this nation will be able to move forward. It's been Barrister St. Moses Obonna with us in the studio. Barrister St. Moses Obonna is the organizing secretary of PDP of your state. Thank you for coming on the program, sir.
Thank you.
Cynthia, that's a much you can take.
Yes, but before we go, we have sports.
Yes, sports, yeah. Sports will be next. All right, don't go away. Sports will be up next with Jonah. Oh, just stay with us.
Show on TV.
Welcome to the sports segment of our program this morning. My name is Jonah Oje. We shall be taking you into the world of sports so that you get to know everything rocking the world of the run leader game. All right, I want to start from our home front where we have Jan Eagles, who are really prosecuting the 2018 African Nations Championship CHAN, and they will be facing Equatorial Guinea today in a match that they must win to progress to the next game, to the next round of the competition. Nigeria will be aiming to avoid elimination from the 2018 African Nations Championship CHAN tournament with victory over Equatorial Guinea at the State Adra in Agade this evening. The Super Eagles head into the clash atop Group C with 4 points from 2 matches, and know that a second successive win will seal their place in the knockout stages of the Continental Showcase, no matter the result between Rwanda and Libya in Tangier. Nigeria followed a goalless draw against the Amavubi of Rwanda with a narrow 1-0 win over the 2000
and 14 Chan champions Libya. Sunday, Ifale netted the only goal of the game in the 79th minute of the match. Head coach Salus Yusuf was happy with his team's tactical discipline in victory over Libya last time, but was quick to highlight the importance of their impending clash against Equatorial Guinea, who have nothing but pride to play for. Head coach of Equatorial Guinea, Rondolof Bodipo, though he's not ready to throw in the towel just yet, has called on his troops to give their all against a much favored Nigerian unit. So it's a good thing there that the Chan Eagles should win Equatorial Guinea to book a place in the next round of that tournament. That is what all Nigerians are really expecting from them, and they should do all they could to score more goals in this match. They have recorded just a goal in their last two games that they played, first against Rwanda and in their next game against Libya, where they defeated them by 1-0. So they should score more. The attacking the attackers of Nigeria should do more to make sure that Nigeria score more goals this evening against the Weeping Boys, Equatorial Guinea. All right, let us now go over to the world of table tennis, where Nigeria's Ronald Kodri was in super form as he started the year for his Portuguese club Sporting on a bright note, leading the Lisbon-based side to retain the 2018 Portuguese Cup. In the final match involving Sporting and ADC Ponta, which Nigeria-born Congo-Brazzaville's Saidi Dou and Nigeria's Jide Ogidipolu, Kodri inspired Sporting to a 3-0 bashing of their opponent in the final held at the High Performance Center in Caldas da Rainha. This wins, which comes ahead of the first leg of the epic quarterfinal battle against our French champion in the European Table Tennis Union Champions League on Friday, June 25, will boost the confidence of Kodri and his teammates. Inspired by the Nigerian export, Kodri, as well as Portuguese international Yao Monteiro, Sporting continued their league fine run with another excellent display to be crowned the cup winner. So we say congratulations to our own Kodri, who is doing his best to make sure that he helps his club, that is Sporting, to retain their club, and also he's helping Nigeria various tournament. We say kudos to him and more power to his able. All right, let us now go over to the English Premier League match that really took place yesterday, and I know that most Liverpool fans are still ruined. They consistency that has continued to bedevil the rest this season, coming from their stunning performance in that last game against the Manchester City, where they defeated the league leaders by 4-3. They thought, many thought, that they were going to trash Swansea yesterday, blue, black and red, but that never came to be, as Swansea defeated them by 1-0. And after that match, the coach of Liverpool was not a happy man. He really criticized his players over their poor performance against Swansea yesterday, and most of the fans really criticized one player in that match who really did not come into the party, and that player is Emre Can. His performance was really, really bad yesterday. He couldn't do much in the midfield to make sure that Liverpool grabbed that three maximum point, but there is every room for improvement. They also have this weekend to make sure that they come back stronger. All right, we go over to boxing, where Anthony Joshua is saying that he will be laughing when Joseph Parker will throw a punch to him. I wonder how that would be possible in the boxing ring, and somebody throwing some boxes to you, some punches to you, and you're laughing about it. He says that he will respond with a defiant smile if Joshua punches cannot put a dent in his renowned chin during their world title unification clash. The New Zealander holds a proud reputation of never being flawed in his unbeaten career ahead of his heavyweight fight with Joshua at the Principality Stadium in Cardiff on March 31. The WBA Super and IBF champion Joshua has found a way to stop all 20 of his opponents, but B.O. King Parker has suggested he could crush the home favorite confidence by standing up to his best shot. Well, this is one fight that many people who love boxing have been, you know, rearing to see. That will come March 31. What will happen between Parker and Anthony Joshua? Well, you will live to see what will happen. Would Anthony Joshua lose his first fight, professional fight? Well, we will see it that day, that he will be facing Parker. He will be facing Parker. But Parker has said, even if Anthony Joshua is throwing punches at him, that he will be putting up defiant smile. Well, we will see what will happen on March the 31st. All right, this is where we'll call it quits on this segment. I hand you over to Ojoba and of course Cynthia Chin.
Thank you very much, Janaoji, for that sports update. Cynthia, you want to get there?
Exactly. Tomorrow promises more interesting package on this platform. We ask you to keep it there with us same time tomorrow.
Right, Unasalati Umabe will come up right after that. Please stay with us. Have a lovely day.
He protects me and he guides me. He